Oké, welkom allemaal bij deze talk van Martijn. Laser cutters on the cheap. Do come in. He will tell you what can go wrong with cheap Chinese laser cutters and maybe how to avoid stuff or improve stuff. So it's interesting. So give it up for Martijn.
Thank you, Dimitri. And yeah, laser cutters on the cheap. So I'm from the hackerspace in Enschede called Tukkelab. And at some point we decided to buy a laser cutter, a cheap Chinese one. Because price, technical, it seems a lot better, but we had some ups and downs with it, and it didn't go over too well. And it didn't go over too well because it's after we bought it, I think we have it for a few years now, but it didn't do anything for most of the time. So be a lot of tinkering and stuff done to it. It's still not totally operational because there's still some problems with the power supply. But here we go. So why to buy a laser cutter? Yeah, it is relatively easy to learn. So that for example, if you use a CNC machine, you have also the Z axis to worry about, and 3D printing also takes a lot of effort to learn the basics of, and also you can do a lot of things wrong with that. And the positive thing about laser cutters is you only have 2D, so it just works like a printer more or less. The more expensive laser cutters do work as a printer as well, and they actually are imported as printer driver. And so if you want to build or you want to have a cheap laser cutter, then you have not really an option to buy the left one, because that is a really expensive one from Trotec. The software is still buggy, but it is a lot less buggy than the Chinese counterparts or the other cheap ones. So you can opt for building maybe your own laser cutter, but then you have troubles from how do you start, and you can adapt a lot of things from the 3D print world to incorporate into your laser cutter, but you have troubles with aligning, vacuuming out the smoke, and also keeping a positive pressure on the device itself. Also a really big thing to consider are laser tubes. There are many types of tubes. Often you see on the websites they say it's about 60 watts, but the problem is they are the maximum power, absolutely rated, that it still should work on, but then you burn down the gases inside and melt the mirror on the front of it. So that's not too good either. We have also CO2 tubes that are continuously pressurized with external gas, but the problem is that you run out of gas relatively fast, and it's rather expensive. It takes about 10-20 euros per hour to operate such a setup. So that's often why the cheaper laser tubes then choose for a sealed system. So then the thing is pre-filled at the factory. And also a pain point with these tubes is that often they are stored for long times with not optimal conditions either within the warehouses, God knows where, to be honest. And also the gases will degrade over time, even when you don't use them, with just storing them. So if you want to buy a tube online, you have to really look for a reputable supplier, because the manufacturing date should be within at least Preferably 1 year, maybe 2 years, but longer than that, and often they aren't stored too well, and yeah, they are not that good anymore, and they have the tendency also to blow out the power supply as well, so that isn't the best thing. So I found a pretty cheap one on eBay, luckily for about 150 euros, but it took a lot of searching and double checking on fora and other stuff like that. What also is really important are mirror and lenses as well. There's also a lot of misinformation about that on the internet. A lot of people claim that you absolutely need gold-coated mirrors, the most high-end stuff. For most laser applications, copper-coated is more than enough, because it can withstand about 300 watts of laser power before it starts to melt off. So most hobby and semi-professional devices rarely exceed that anyways. Also, when you are building a laser cutter yourself, then you have all these mount points. The left one is the laser, this one is the lens assembly, so the lens is over there. And it's also really important that you have a correct one, that you have the correct focusing depth and things like that. It's also the same thing next to it, just without the manifolds to show it a little bit better. Also, this one is the positive pressure. That is often forgotten when people build their own devices, their own laser cutters as well, because it doesn't seem too important, but it makes sure that the fire doesn't arc back into the lens itself and stuff like that. And also good pumps that maintains pressure evenly is also pretty important too. Another big thing is what I forgot to mention with the tubes is cooling as well. The cooling is really important, because if you exceed about 30 degrees Celsius, then the tube starts overheating and they start failing a lot faster than they are supposed to. And often you don't see that, and even on professional machines they also leave proper cooling out of the equation as well. But then again, they have contracts sometimes that they just replace them once a half year, once a year. The brains and the software is also a really fun one about Chinese laser cutters, because what I learned over the process is what Chinese people actually use laser cutters for. That is not for cutting anything, but it is just for engraving and marking out stuff on planes and so you run into first really strange translating errors and stuff like that. The only thing it works with is CorelDRAW, because that is what the Chinese companies use, and only that for some reason. So not any proper design software at all. And and if you design something in a different program that is even vectorized, then the plugin you have to install into CorelDRAW doesn't work with it at all, to be honest. For example, if you have a few rounds that you want to cut out, if you have round shapes, this especially this plugin that is shipped with almost all laser cutters that come from that region, then it is really just you really don't know where the cuts end up. They are round, but they could be anywhere on the plate you load into it. So that's not good at all. But the good thing about if you have a cheap laser cutter is that you can just pull out all of the existing hardware and then replace it with a smoothie board, for example, or any other type of board. They all have their own flaws and shortcomings, but at least they are somewhat documented and functional. You can also a smoothie board knockoff the MK-base two the devices. They are also pretty strange because they have some different firmware at times. Depending on the vendor, they also don't have the standard pinouts for a lot of things, and they are missing a lot of features altogether sometimes, and not completely populated at all in some parts. So the brains and the is also you just buy the thing and just take out the cheap Chinese version of it and then replace it with something more suitable. And also power supplies is also a really nice one, because if you buy it, then you get a nice diagram with it. I learned recently that they all use the same chip for it. It works pretty well when you wire it up to a potentiometer, but the problem then is often they don't calibrate them at all in the factory either, so then you have to tinker around with it, and the pots that you have to adjust it with aren't described at all what they do. So the what I did was just try and fidget around with it, and after someone at our hackerspace Renze and Mark did some reverse engineering, it panned out that I was adjusting the voltage and amperage. Also a really important thing with the power supply is that you at least reach the ignition voltage of the tube, because the most of the power supplies that are sold don't peak long enough to actually ignite any tube at all. So that is also a fun one. So that's also a thing that you have to really be careful with. Another thing to watch out for is that the Chinese power supplies do lack a lot of security features as well. So when you unplug or something fails inside, often the default fail state is that they turn on full. And when I hooked this one, when I calibrated it so it worked properly with the potentiometer test setup that the manufacturer recommended when I hooked it up to the control board, it went out completely out of whack again, because there was some strange circuit decisions made in the power supply. I didn't look at the circuit myself, to be honest, because I was a little bit defeated already. And eventually someone else fixed that. But the problem was the control wires were tied into the water the detection, so that it gave really weird specs when you connected it to anything other than the potentiometer. But I guess that a lot of people then just give up and toss the power supply. So what I really recommend to do is, you can buy a relatively cheap CO2 tube, but then the best bet is to buy a decent power supply from a recommended supplier, and not a Chinese type thing, but more USA based one or Europe based one. But I have seen that the USA made power supplies are a little bit more cheaper than the Europe ones. I think, to be honest, the American ones are also pretty also probably made in China as well. Does anyone have any questions?
You said you replaced the electronics. Did you replace it with a smoothie board or?
Yeah, I completely replaced it with a smoothie board because it was it looked like it was purpose built for the laser cutter as well as the 3D printing and CNC.
So you said you ran into that the smoothie board also wasn't perfect. What kind of issues did you run into?
Mostly pins that were not broken out or mismatched pin headers that were not compatible with the original.
But no strange laser cutters that you said that the circles ended up in weird places and that sort of stuff?
No, that's not. That was not the case. It is just with the Chinese control boards.
Okay, so after replacement, the actual engraving and cutting quality was good.
Yes, that was fine because the stepper motors are actually also pretty commonly used in 3D printers from China as well. Any other questions?
Would you recommend people to buy a smoothie board or a clone of a smoothie board or something else entirely?
What I recommend people to do is buy the original because then you have the community that you can fall back on to ask questions because they think the clone boards are poisonous to the community. So when they find out that you have a clone one, you don't get any support at all. So you have to figure it out all on yourself. So that is also not the best.
The image you had in the front of the laser cutter being on fire, explain.
Well, that I chose that one because of the fail state of the most power supplies of the laser cutters. When something fails, the device stops, but the laser tube turns on to max power. So then
was
it starts
that your
to fire.
Laser?
No, luckily not. I think I loaned that one from a Hackaday article that actually explains the problem they had that the laser cutter stopped and went full power.
Maybe also an interesting point, you said the overpressure at the tip. We have a laser cutter tech for you too, it didn't have that. So we built that ourselves. I found out that a really good compressor for that is the compressor from an old refrigerator. They are really silent. They provide quite constant and even air, and they're perfect for this.
Yeah, I think the best versions are two-stroke compressors, also found in the refrigerators, because then you don't get puffs of air, but just continuous streaming.
And old refrigerators are cheap.
That too.
Often free.
Any other questions?